Hello. Our medieval location this year has been in this North Yorkshire village since around 1300. The two Thames playing this week turned up a little more recently, namely Freya McClements and Paddy Duffy for Northern Ireland and Paul Sinner and Marcus Berkman playing for the south of England. Collectively, they know a great many things, useful and useless, but can they pull out the right bit at the right moment? We're going to find out over the next half hour. The teams get all of the questions now. You may hear the odd murmur in the background as they begin to confer, and you can have them at hand too. If you look at our webpage, you should be able to see today's questions set out without the answers, obviously. They're going to get 6 points for a perfect answer without any help from me, but as soon as I have to nudge them or steer them or direct them away, they'll start dropping points. It's always a bit subjective, but we do try and be even-handed. Before we start them off, let me give you the answer to last week's teaser question. I asked then, where were these all to be found in the 1970s? The environmental adventures of a spiritual guru, a precipitous little vehicle, Josephine's feline band, and a possible miniature version of a satirical magazine. I think you needed to be of a certain age to see the solution here, but they are all clues to forgotten cartoon series made by the Hanna-Barbera studios in the 1970s and shown in the UK on children's television. The environmental adventures are those of Yogi's gang, who went around cleaning up pollution. The precipitous vehicle is Speed Buggy. The feline band are Josie and the Pussycats. And the possible miniature version of a satirical magazine is Inch High Private Eye. 6 points to you, well deserved if you spotted the link there. Now, before they get too much thinking time, let's turn to today's quiz. Good luck to all of you. Freya and Paddy, here comes your first question of 2020. I think it's quite a gentle one, but then it's easy for me because I can see the answers. What's needed to transform a matrimonial promise into Lincoln's faithful canine, Aschenbach's last resort, and the Queen of Carthage? What's needed to transform a matrimonial promise into Lincoln's faithful canine, Aschenbach's last resort, and the Queen of Carthage?
You think it's gentle, do we? Yes, I think we do. Because, well, we'll go backwards, because the Queen of Carthage, in addition to having a great pop career, is Dido.
And that's
then
right.
Aschenbach's last resort, we think that might be referring to Thomas Mann's Death in Venice and the Lido.
It is the Lido or the Lido, yeah.
And then, so working back again, Lincoln's faithful canine Fido.
Did you know his dog was called Fido, or you were just working by?
No, we did.
I believe you.
5 minutes for you to doubt us. And then the matrimonial promise, I do, so IDO. So in each case, you're adding a letter. Different letters to the front of it.
Very good indeed. You've started excellently. 6 points to you. Fairly straightforward wordplay there. What's needed to transform a matrimonial promise, I do, into Lincoln's faithful canine? You need an F to turn it into Fido. Aschenbach's last resort, the Lido in Venice, you need an L. And the Queen of Carthage, you add a D to get Dido. Did you know that Lincoln's dog was also, I suppose, assassinated? Somebody later said that his later owner said that he'd put his paws on a drunk in the street and the drunk had pulled out a knife and stabbed him, this poor innocent dog. So the dog met the same fate as the original owner. Now, south of England, you might be a little rattled by that, but I think you'll find this one within your powers too. If you're a regulator with no real powers, a bureaucrat who's anonymous and unaccountable, or someone who's drunk, in what sense might you sympathise with Samson in Gaza? If you're a regulator with no real powers, a bureaucrat who's anonymous and unaccountable, or someone who's drunk, in what sense might you sympathise with Samson in Gaza?
Well, I've never been a regulator with no real powers or a bureaucrat who's anonymous and accountable. But the third one seems vaguely familiar. And I think if you were someone who's drunk, you might be described as legless.
You might indeed, yeah.
So from there we go to a bureaucrat who's anonymous and unaccountable must be faceless.
That's right.
And then eyeless in Gaza rings a bell as as getting its title from John Milton's Samson Agonistes. So was Samson eyeless in Gaza?
Samson was eyeless in Gaza at the mill with slaves, a line from Milton. Which was taken by Aldous Huxley as a title.
And the last one was bugging me for a while.
And me.
Because you, presumably armless might be, or powerless, but then power's not a part of the body.
No.
And then it got it in the end. Toothless.
Toothless. Toothless. Very good.
Yes. Well, a toothless watchdog or a toothless.
Very good. Yeah.
So they all sympathise with each other because they all metaphorically are missing part of their anatomy.
They are all missing parts of the body. So a regulator with no real powers could be described as toothless. A bureaucrat who's anonymous could be described as faceless. Someone who's drunk, legless. In what sense might they all sympathise with Samson in Gaza? Because he was eyeless in Gaza. Well, my prediction was right. You made short work of that. 6 points to you, too. So, Northern Ireland, listen to these pieces of music. What makes them essential? So, Paddy and Freya, what makes those pieces essential?
Well, we think the essential is a reference to air or oxygen, which obviously is pretty essential to life, really. Paddy will explain further.
Yeah, so it was a nice eclectic group of musical choices there. There was Air in the G String by Bach was the first one.
That's right, yep.
And then there was Oxygen Part 4, I think it's sort of sometimes referred to as Jean-Michel Jarre.
Yep. Absolutely right.
And so we've had a German and a French, and sort of to continue this sort of globetrotting, an Australian duo, Air Supply, with I'm All Out of Love. So we've got air, oxygen, and air.
Beautifully done. You did it almost in one breath. It's another six for you. We played Jazz Bach, Air from the Third Orchestral Suite in D Major, Air on a G String, as it's better known, Jean-Michel Jarre, Oxygen, Part 4, and Air Supply, All Out of Love. And they're all essential because without them, you would stifle. Well done. So, the south of England, this is your next question. Someone called Michael was inspired by a Humphrey Bogart film. Someone called Robbie was inspired by an American jazz saxophonist. Someone called Stefani was inspired by a Queen song. Who was inspired by two members of a 1960s British R&B band and a horse in a TV sitcom? Someone called Michael was inspired by a Humphrey Bogart film. Someone called Robbie was inspired by an American jazz saxophonist. Someone called Stefani was inspired by a Queen song. Who was inspired by two members of a 1960s British R&B band and a horse in a TV sitcom?
Okay, some of this is quite straightforward and some of it is not. But someone called Stefani, spelt S-T-E-F-A-N-I, was inspired by a Queen song. Well, that's Lady Gaga. So she's changed her name. These are all about people who've taken on stage names. Now,
you've got the general theme, yeah. Certainly. Yeah.
And Robbie is inspired by, well, it's Robbie Coltrane. He's called McDonald, I think, something like that. But he was a big John Coltrane fan.
Originally called Macmillan. Yeah, you don't lose a point for that. You've got the right answer. He's Robbie Coltrane.
That third one, presumably, is a reference to Hercules from Steptoe and Son.
It is.
Rather than the Miliband who changed his name to Ed from Mr. Ed seems unlikely. So it's
no, you've got the right. You've got the right TV horse.
That's the middle name of Elton John.
Of Elton John. And so the two members of the 1960s British R&B band are Elton Dean and Long John Baldry. I think, is that right?
It is absolutely right. Yeah.
And so Elton John took his name from those two, and he got the. But the problem is the first one. So I've been trying to think of Michaels who changed their name. It's a guess, but the only Michael I can think of who definitely changed his name was Michael Keaton, the actor who was originally Michael Douglas. But there was already a Michael Douglas, so he changed his name to Keaton. I can't think of any others.
There's another famous name change, Michael.
Oh.
And he's an actor too.
Okay.
I mean, the only Humphrey Bogart. It doesn't say characters, does it?
I can pretty much guarantee that if I give you his original name, you'll know who I'm talking about. His name changes.
Morris Micklewhite.
Oh,
you have a
Kane Mutiny.
Of course.
Kane Mutiny. Oh my lord, how long?
Very good.
So yes, someone called Michael was inspired by Humphrey Bogart film. Michael Caine took his surname from the Bogart movie, The Caine Mutiny. Someone called Robbie, inspired by American jazz saxophonist. Robbie Coltrane, the actor, took his surname from John Coltrane. Someone called Stefani was inspired by a Queen song. That's where you started on this question. Lady Gaga took her stage name in tribute to the Queen song Radio Gaga. And finally, who was inspired by two members of a 1960s British R&B band? Well, you got all the names right. Elton John took his name from the two colleagues in the band Bluesology, the saxophonist Elton Dean and the singer Long John Baldry. I didn't have to tell you anything there. I just had to wait a moment for you to get there. So I think I find it very hard to dock you a point. I think we'll have to give you six, south of England. This is a very high-scoring contest. Nobody has dropped a point yet. So, Northern Ireland, can we continue on that line? Your next question has come to us by through a Round Britain quiz listener, Dudley Hilsden. How might the following lead you reluctantly to a 13th century Watergate? A son of a knight who may have warned of an impending parliamentary disaster? A lieutenant colonel from Scotland, remembered in Northern Ireland? A broadcaster on Radio Hamburg, and a number three with a Kipling connection. How might the following lead you reluctantly to a 13th century Watergate? A son of a knight who may have warned of an impending parliamentary disaster. A lieutenant colonel from Scotland, remembered in Northern Ireland. A broadcaster on Radio Hamburg, and a number three with a Kipling connection.
Let's start with what we know. The broadcaster on Radio Hamburg. When I went to university in Galway, I used to have to walk from the campus up Bohemore Hill back home. And in Bohemore Cemetery was a man called William Joyce, who was known for his Hamburg calling broadcast, Lord Haw Haw.
You've got the right broadcaster.
And then from there we have a couple of lines of inquiry open in every conceivable direction, and so it's just a matter of trying to close it down. Now, the 13th century Watergate, we're looking for a literal Watergate, or are we looking for a break-in at the 1200s Democratic headquarters?
You're not looking for a 13th century equivalent of the
so we're not
the
looking
plumbers.
For a scandal?
No.
Okay.
We're looking
it's
for
it's a literal Watergate.
Something in a castle?
Something in a castle.
In a very famous castle.
A very famous castle. Tower of London?
It is the Tower of London, yep.
And the number three with a Kipling connection. We were wondering if the Kipling connection was Kim.
It is.
And the number three being the fact that Kim is the third of Courtney and Chloe. Is it the Kardashians? Is that the way you're going with this?
Well, that was a wildly lateral sidestep, I must say.
I was trying to expand the radio
extra,
four
extra
canon.
I thought you were right onto it there because you started so well.
Is it number three of the Cambridge Five, Kim Philby?
That's there we who are. Yeah.
I was, of course, just decoying for the gaiety of the nation there.
And of course, that's how, because they were spies, so they end up in the Tower of London for treason.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So that's how they're led reluctantly to the 13th century.
A lieutenant colonel from Scotland remembered in.
So do you know what the 13th century Watergate in question is? It has a particular name. It's a particularly well-known gate at the Tower of London?
Traitor's Gate.
Traitor's Gate.
Traitor's Gate. Here, the Lieutenant Colonel from Scotland must be Lundy.
It is.
Oh, yes, of course.
Yes,
Robert Lundy, yeah. Yes. Yeah. Just explain a little bit for those who don't know about Robert Lundy.
Yes, he was a traitor during the Siege of Derry. He sort of got his name during sort of the Siege of Derry, and his name has been used pejoratively ever since for anyone who kind of...
He advised surrender at the Siege of Londonderry.
And then fled,
And so what about the son of a knight who may have warned of an impending parliamentary disaster? Tough element, this, I think.
So we've got Kingfield.
The son of a knight. This is somebody who is literally sort of the...
Cambridge spies.
It's a very famous parliamentary disaster in the sense that didn't actually occur, but might have done.
Oh, the exploding of Parliament.
Indeed, the gunpowder plot, but...
Robert Catesby and Fox.
It's not Catesby. I don't think you're going to work back to this. It's... Francis Tresham, who was a cousin of Robert Catesby, and he's widely believed to have been the author of the anonymous letter which was delivered to Lord Mounteagle and warned him to stay away from the House of Lords on the 5th of November, and that alerted the authorities to the plot.
I see.
So, how might the following lead you reluctantly to a 13th century Watergate? The 13th century Watergate was Traitor's Gate in the Tower of London. The son of a knight who may have warned of an impending parliamentary disaster was Francis Tresham. The Lieutenant Colonel from Scotland, remembered in Northern Ireland, is Robert Lundy. The broadcaster on Radio Hamburg, you got very quickly, was William Joyce, Lord Haw Haw. And finally, the number three with a Kipling connection was Philby, Harold Philby, who was nicknamed after Kim in the novel by Kipling. So you struggled a little on that one. You've done so well up to now, but I think we'll give you four. That may be seen by some as generous, but let's be generous. So, south of England, Marcus and Paul, it's time for a music question. Which of these three would you want fighting your corner?
In the mangrove swamps by the python rumps, there is peace from 12 to 2. Even caribous lie around and snooze, for there's nothing else to do. In Bengal, to move at all is seldom, if ever, done. But mad dogs and Englishmen go out in the midday, 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 out in the midday sun.
The best things in life are free, but you can give them to the birds and bees.
So, Marcus and Paul, which of those three would you want fighting in your corner?
Well, definitely not number two.
Because he's Noel Coward, and that was Mad Dogs and Englishmen.
Yeah.
And I've been sitting there going through Star Trek, which was the first one, and thinking, what could this be? Is it Kirk? Is it Spock? I'm going through the whole cast, going through all the producers.
And it's Alexander Courage.
Who composed the music?
Who composed the music, indeed. Alexander Courage composed that very famous theme.
So that's obviously the answer is Alexander Courage. You'd want him fighting your corner, I think, rather than Noel Coward.
Definitely you want Courage rather than Coward, but what about the final piece? Do you want him in your corner or not in
your
corner?
Well, it's unlikely, because you only want... Oh, you haven't specified how many people. I thought it was just going to be which one of these three would we want fighting.
We didn't say which one of these three.
All right.
I think this is the first ever Motown number one. And I can't for the life of me remember what it is.
I even recognise his voice and I can't think of it. It's Money Money, obviously.
Not Money Money.
No, it's Money. It's Money. The one that the Flying Lizards did later on.
Yeah, Money, that's what I want.
He's got a very famous voice.
I know that
out
if
I, there. I know if I let you
Lamont
take a walk.
Dozier.
No, it's not Lamont Dozier.
Because if he was dozier, you wouldn't want him fighting your corner.
Well, that's... I think if you took a walk around the garden, you'd come back with this, but we don't have the time for you today. It's quite a big garden here, so we don't have the time for that. I think I may have to give you this. You're absolutely right that it was the first ever hit for Tamla Motown. Barrett's Strong.
Oh, God. I could not hit the post anymore with them all.
Money, that's what I want. I don't know how much of the money he got, but it certainly set Tamla Motown going. So we played Alexander Courage, the theme from Star Trek. You identified that correctly. We played Mad Dogs and Englishmen, Noel Coward. You identified that correctly. Finally, Barrett Strong singing Money, That's What I Want. You couldn't quite get to the name, for which I think I will dock a point. So, Northern Ireland, your final question of this game. When and why could you once have encountered a president plotting in Virginia, a communist revolutionary in a French kitchen, a Bundeskanzler serving drinks in a disco, and a pontiff standing outside one? When and why could you once have encountered a president plotting in Virginia, a communist revolutionary in a French kitchen, a Bundeskanzler serving drinks in a disco, and a pontiff standing outside one?
We've got a couple of irons in the fire here again, because lots of us, certainly the initial presidents of the US, were all from Virginia, so they all would have plotted in their own way at different points. However, the communist revolutionary in a French kitchen, there is, I believe, a more literal connection in that Ho Chi Minh did train as a pastry chef. Is that what we're looking for?
It is. Ho Chi Minh is the communist revolutionary we're after. Yep. He, in fact, worked on a French steamer, and then he worked as a kitchen hand at the Ritz in Paris.
So the Bundeskanzler is the chancellor, German chancellor. Are we looking for one who formerly worked in a bar?
Who was literally somebody's... Was that Gerhard Schröder? Was he a...
No.
Oh, perhaps... Helmut Kohl, didn't he? He took somebody for, it was like a kind of, it was a beer and bratwurst diplomacy or something, was it?
I have to say, I can't state with absolute confidence that Helmut Kohl never worked in a disco, but he's not the one we're looking for.
I
imagine all German chancellors had some slightly odd jobs in their youth, but no, this is a particular. Worked in an East German disco.
East German, so...
Oh, well, initially we did have Angela Merkel, and we thought Bundeskanzlerin might have not been there, might have cancelled it right.
Yeah, I don't know whether they're very strict about feminizing their terms, but no, Angela Merkel.
So we steered ourselves down.
Now, what about the pontiff standing outside?
The pontiff is the Pope. So the question is, which pope are we looking for? Because there are many, many, many popes.
A pope standing outside a disco.
Yeah. I think if I tell you where the disco is, you'll immediately get the Pope. So
it's probably Pope Francis then, because he was standing outside a bar in Buenos Aires.
He was indeed, yeah.
Right.
He used to work as a nightclub bouncer. Makes a fantastic paella as well, apparently.
Good to know.
Benedict in his retirement must be treated very well.
Now, what about the president plotting in Virginia? You're right to say
there are a lot of them,
but there's a lot of choice, but there's a particular point to the word plotting here.
A
plotter, or somebody that had a stake of land, like Mount Vernon and George Washington, for example.
George Washington. Was in fact George Washington. His first official job
was as a surveyor.
And he spent a lot of time plotting and surveying territory and property in the Shenandoah Valley and various other places. So when and why could you have encountered a president plotting in Virginia? You were misled by the wording of that question, as I'm sure the setter intended you to be. The plotting we had in mind was surveying. It was George Washington, a communist revolutionary in a French kitchen at sea and in Paris, was Ho Chi Minh, Nguyen Tat Tan. A Bundeskanzler serving drinks in a disco was Angela Merkel. And finally, the pontiff standing outside one was Pope Francis I. I think it's 3 points there, because I had to sort of nudge you along several times. You've got a couple of the essential elements, but you needed a bit of steering to get the whole question. So 3 points to you, Northern Ireland. So... Marcus and Paul, your final question. If Blondie's second begat Indiana's first, a French lexicographer's second begat a Canadian novelist's first, and a pair of British post-impressionists' second begat a Vitis' first, which relation of Kukulin won the Formula One World Championship? If Blondie's second begat Indiana's first, a French lexicographer's second begat a Canadian novelist's first, and a pair of British post-impressionists' second begat a Vitis' first, which relation of Kukulin won the Formula One World Championship?
I think it's fair to say that we're not terribly sure about this, but...
Look, there's a lot going on in this question. It's hard
there
to imagine more
on.
Diverse cultural references within one question.
Are we talking about names here? So we're looking at, if Blondie's second, presumably that's Debbie Harry, so are we talking Harry?
Yes.
Good. So Indiana Jones's first name is Henry.
No, that's not what we're looking
it's
for.
It's not.
But you've somehow got... right on the spot and disappeared off in a different direction.
Okay.
Right, let's move on. French lexicographer, I think there's only one we can think of.
Think about begat and what that means. Do you know any French lexicographers?
Roger?
No.
Ah, damn.
No, so one. That was wrong.
A Canadian novelist.
Is that
Margaret?
Margaret Atwood, so it must be...
It isn't Margaret Atwood.
It isn't Margaret Atwood.
It mustn't be anything.
Good.
Is it Jan Martel?
No.
VC's first is Victoria, presumably?
No.
Oh, we're doing well here.
It's a tough question, this one. I don't think you should beat yourself up.
So is the VC a specific person who's won the VC?
Yes, quite recently, actually. Quite a recent VC.
Johnson B. Harry?
Aye.
You've got the right VC.
So Johnson.
Yeah. So you might be able to work backwards from that to who might have sired Johnson.
Oh, so we had an idea, didn't we, for the post-impressionists?
Are we talking about
John? Oh, right, okay. So
I think the light bulb has gone off.
So Harry begat Harrison Ford.
Harrison Ford.
And Gwen and Augustus John begat Johnson Buhari.
Those were the Johns that begat the Johnson. So
the French lexicographer, who isn't Roger.
A Canadian novelist that ends S-O-N. It's not Jan Martel.
Robertson Davis.
Robertson Davis is the man we're looking for. So the...
So the lexicographer must be Robert someone.
Robert.
It is Robert. The Petit Robert is a very famous French dictionary. Now, finally, the relation of Kukulin leading to the Formula One World Championship.
Right, so, it's obviously somebody that ends in S-O-N.
Yes, I think we've got...
You're looking... I would point out to you, you're looking for first names in every case here.
Yes.
I mean, there's Deirdre and there's... Deirdre and...
You might do better if you think about the
Formula One. You need win the Formula One World Championship.
The youngest, but at the time, the youngest to win it, Emerson Fittipaldi.
Perfect.
There we are.
Emma.
And Emma, E-M-E-R.
E-M-E-R is the wife of Kukulin. Yeah.
Dear God, that was a struggle.
That was tough.
Yeah, it was a sort of multi-lap race, that, wasn't it, before we reached the checkered flag. I think that was a two-point answer myself. It felt like I was doing a bit of the heavy lifting there. So I'm afraid it's only 2 points, south of England. Which means that at the end of today's contest, it's a draw. The scores are 19 points to Northern Ireland and 19 to the south of England. I have to say, I didn't know that as I was giving the points out there, so... I'm free of influence. Thank you to all of you. In March, these pairs will face one another again. I doubt if we're going to get a draw this time, but I don't know who's going to come first. You only have to wait until next week to hear Paddy and Freya in action again. They're going to be playing the Scots, so we look forward to that. And I'll give you the solution to this puzzle, which is going to be available on our webpage for you to read at leisure if you want to. There's an indefinite reason why you might assign a large quantity, gather a team for a sea voyage, confront what you are charged and bear witness to something challenging. Can you explain? As I say, it's on our website. No prizes, don't write in, but you can see if you've got the right answer next week. Until then, goodbye. God. Well, that was... You came out of the... You came steaming out of the blocks with six pointers, yeah. And then suddenly...
It's almost like the questions get harder as you get older.
Yeah. I had to do a walking tour of Galway to try and play this on Tuesday.
Yeah.
If I just remembered Johnson Buhari's name earlier, I would have worked out the John thing. But
yeah,
I think that was
a tricky question.
So long to work out what his name was.
Yeah.
Because the Alexander Courage one's just something I learned about 3 weeks ago. That he was the real... Because everyone that thinks it's Jerry Goldsmith who wrote the theme tune.
Yes,
He wrote the theme tune to The Next Generation.
That's right, yeah.
There's a story about Alexander Courage composing that theme tune because Gene Roddenberry wrote some lyrics for the theme tune and claimed half of Courage's royalties.
That's right, yeah.
And Courage wouldn't speak to him ever again and never worked for Roddenberry.
Oh, he successfully claimed half.
He went to ASCAP or BMI or whichever who it was and said, but the lyrics were never sung by anyone. He did it purely in order to get half of Courage's money.
Shocker.
Absolutely. I'd never heard of Robert Lundy, but he's a sort of obviously a figure of some...
Very famous. And he's also quite a big figure in Orange culture, in a sense, in Northern Ireland, the culture of the Apprentice Boys and the Apprentice Boys of Derry, who are a loyal order, similar to the Orange Order. They burn him. They burn his effigy in the centre of Derry every December because he was prepared to open the gates and sacrifice the city. Yeah.
Right. Very good. Cup of tea.
Tea.